Origin and Evolution of Life. The Earth is presumed to have originated about 4.6 billion years ago. Life came into existence gradually. The origin of life on the Earth is also called protobiogenesis. It is clear that life came into existence from the non-living substances of the primordial Earth about 3 billion years ago. The origin of life can be explained by some of these theories. 1. Theory of special creation. According to this, all the living beings on the Earth were created by God or by some supernatural power. 2. Cosmozoic theory. According to this, life on Earth came from a distant planet in the form of spores or microorganisms. 3. Theory of spontaneous generation or theory of abiogenesis. According to this, life originated from non-living material spontaneously without any interruption. 4. Theory of biogenesis. This theory could not explain the origin of first life on Earth, but satisfactorily explain the continuity of life. According to biogenesis, living organisms are always produced from pre-existing living forms by reproduction and not from non-living or lifeless matter. Now, modern self-assembly theory. It holds that origin of life on Earth occurred due to inherent property of chemical molecules of self-organization or self-assembly. The primordial events of conversion of micromolecules to macromolecules to organize cell-like microsystem, and these events were speculated to be probably direct, simple, fast, and occur frequently on the Earth. The scientist Reed demonstrated an intermolecular assembly by assembling two protein molecules, which resulted into enzymatically active complexes. Oparin-Helden theory of chemical evolution. The entire process of chemical evolution can be divided into following steps. 1. Origin of Earth and its primitive atmosphere. Evidences suggest that Earth originated about 4.6 billion years ago. When it was broken from the sun, it was a glowing fire and a rotating cloud of hot gases, vapors of various elements, pieces of rocks and metals called nebula. This mass of gas exploded with a big bang into several small pieces, and the Earth as a piece was broken from the sun. As it was moving away from the sun, the temperature slowly decreased, and this led to the condensation of gas. The heavy elements like iron, nickel, etc. sank to the center and formed the solid core of Earth. The lightest elements like helium, hydrogen, oxygen occupied the atmosphere of the Earth. Then next step, formation of ammonia, water and methane. The Earth was very hot initially, and so the atoms could not combine with each other very easily. The primitive Earth contained a large amount of hydrogen, carbon, oxygen, nitrogen. Of these, hydrogen was very active and combined with nitrogen to form ammonia, with oxygen to form water, and with carbon to form methane. As the temperature was high, ammonia and methane remained as gases and water as steam. As years passed, the temperature of the Earth decreased, steam condensed into water, which resulted in rain, and the Earth became cold. Water gradually accumulated, and this led to the formation of rivers, streams, lakes, seas, and oceans. Compounds like ammonia, methane were dissolved in rainwater and accumulated in the sea. Next step, synthesis of simple organic compounds. Formation of micromolecules. When the temperature of the Earth's surface considerably cooled down, then the free radicals CH and CH2 condensed to form a variety of both saturated and unsaturated hydrocarbons. Helden described the sea containing molecules of these organic substances in abundance. as the hot dilute soup or primitive broth. In that, formation of complex organic compounds. The hot dilute soup was sterile and oxygen-free. Simple organic substances came together in increasing numbers. They collided, reacted, and aggregated, forming new complex molecules such as polysaccharides, fats, proteins, nucleosides, and nucleotides. The protein molecules made their existence by polymerization of amino acids. These are called protoproteins. Due to enzymatic nature, these proteins accelerated the rate of other chemical reactions. The formation of protein molecules is considered as a landmark in the origin of life. In that formation of nucleic acid, it was formed by aggregation of phosphoric acid, sugar, purines, and pyrimidines. They were linked in various combinations to form different types of nucleotides. In this formation of protobiont or precell, the nucleic acid along with inorganic and organic molecules form the first form of life. It is called protobionts or precell. Then formation of first cell, the nucleic acid in precells had the capacity to multiply gradually and started directing series of chemical reactions like protein synthesis. This chemical evolution led to biological evolution. Then biological evolution. The first or primitive cells were marine and heterotrophic in nature. They obtained their food from the surrounding area. Growth and multiplication of these cells caused depletion in the food and increase in CO2 due to fermentation. This resulted in the development of chromophores. The chromophores had the ability to trap light energy and convert it into chemical energy. Now, Urey and Miller's experiment in support of chemical evolution. Urey and Miller's spark discharge apparatus is a closed system of glass except for tungsten electrode. It has a large spark discharge glass chamber fitted with tungsten electrodes. Plus, for water boiling, a side tube connected to a vacuum pump, a cooling jacket, and U-shaped trap. They first evacuated the entire apparatus and made it sterile. Water was partially added to the flask. Mixture of methane, ammonia, and hydrogen in the ratio 1:2:2 was slowly passed through the stopcock without allowing air. It was done to create the prebiotic atmosphere. The flask was boiled at a very low temperature to provide the necessary water vapors for the reaction. This was simulating the ocean present on primitive Earth. Water vapors along with other gases were circulated continuously through the high electric sparks of 75,000 volts. The mixture was exposed continuously to electric discharge, that is, stimulating lightning, causing the gases to interact. Then the mixture of gases was allowed to pass through condenser where gases condensed to liquid. The liquefied mixture was collected in the trap present at the bottom of the apparatus. Observation: it was found that variety of simple organic compounds, especially amino acids and sugars, were found. Significance: the formation of amino acid, sugar, and other simple organic compounds by recreating the conditions that might have prevailed on the primitive Earth in the laboratory was demonstrated. Inference: the experiment provided vital proof that the essential building blocks for the first living organisms could have been formed on primordial Earth. Then, organic evolution. Evolution means gradual change. Organic evolution can be defined as a slow, gradual, continuous, and irreversible changes through which the present-day complex forms have descended from their simple pre-existing forms of the past. Charles Darwin used the term for evolution as descent with modification. Now, theories of organic evolution. First, Darwin's theory. Darwin's theory of organic evolution by natural selection is based on following principle. 1. Overproduction or enormous fertility or prodigality of production. Every living organism has a great potential for reproduction. All organisms produce more young ones than those which can survive up to maturity. Regardless of rate of reproduction of a species, its number remains constant under fairly stable environment because of the struggle for existence. 2. Struggle for existence. According to Darwin, individuals multiply in geometric ratio, but the space and food remain constant. This leads to competition for getting requirements of life, and it is called struggle for existence. In that, intraspecific struggle is the competition among the individuals of the same species. Interspecific struggle is the struggle between the organisms of different species living together. And environmental struggle is the struggle of all living forms against adverse environmental conditions such as natural calamities, heat, cold, drought, storms, earthquakes, etc. Then, variation and heredity. Variations are the differences between individuals of the same species. Variations may be harmful, neutral, or useful. According to Darwin, the useful variations are preserved and passed on to their offspring. Then, survival of the fittest or natural selection. The organisms provided with favorable variations succeed in the struggle for existence, while the organisms with unfavorable variations are unfit to survive and they perish. So, this means survival of the fittest. Then, origin of new species. As a result of struggle for existence, variability and inheritance, the organisms tend to become better adapted to their environment. Hence, in each and every generation, there is slight betterment of the already developed character. Then, objections to Darwin's theory of natural selection. The main drawback of Darwinism is that this theory has no satisfactory explanation for the cause, origin, and inheritance of variation. So, another theory, Hugo de Varis' theory. He proposed mutation theory to explain the process of organic evolution. Hugo proposed this theory by studying the plant called evening primrose for 7 generations. He observed certain striking differences in the forms which appeared suddenly amongst a population of normal evening primrose. He called this phenomenon as mutation and the change forms as mutant. The term mutation means sudden change taking place in the genetic material of the organisms that are heritable. The main features of mutation theory are it provides the raw material for organic evolution by which the new species originates. Objections for the theory. The variation observed by Hugo were not really gene mutations, but were actually due to chromosomal aberrations that have little value in evolution. Now, modern synthetic theory of evolution. It is the theory of organic evolution by natural selection of inherited characteristics, explaining the concept of the theory of natural selection of Charles Darwin and mutation theory of Hugo. A group of similar individuals interbreeding among themselves, occupying a geographical area, is called genetic population or Mendelian population. The population is considered as unit of evolution because new species are evolved from population and not from a single individual. The sum total of genes of all individuals of interbreeding population is called gene pool. The proportion of an allele in the gene pool as compared with other alleles at the same locus is gene frequency. The concept of the modern synthetic theory. It consists of three main concepts. 1. Genetic variation. 2. Natural selection. And 3. Isolation. So first, genetic variation. The change in gene and gene frequencies is genetic variation. It is the raw material for evolution. It is caused by the following factors. 1. Gene mutation. They introduce variations in the gene pool and account for the change in gene frequency. Then gene flow, the transfer of genes between populations that differ genetically from one another is gene flow. Then genetic recombination, in sexually reproducing organisms during gametogenesis, the homologous chromosomes exchange genetic material by the process of crossing over. And this produces new combinations, and the phenomenon is genetic recombination, which is responsible for variation. Then genetic drift. Any alteration in allele frequency in the natural population by pure chance is genetic drift. Smaller populations have greater chances for genetic drift, and it is also called Sewall-Wright effect. Then chromosomal aberration. It refers to the structural alterations in a chromosome causing changes in the gene arrangement. For example, deletion, duplication, etc. Then second concept, natural selection. It is a link between changes in the environment and genetic variations of the species attempting to survive and reproduce. It brings about evolutionary changes by favoring differential reproduction of genes that bring about changes in gene frequency from one generation to another. Natural selection invariably encourages those genes that assure highest degree of adaptive efficiency between population and its environment. The most common example of this is industrial melanism. It is the example for natural selection in action, which refers to development of dark-colored papered moths in response to air pollution during the Industrial Revolution. Industrial Revolution in Great Britain. The dark-colored moths develop as a result of random mutation. Before the Industrial Revolution, light-colored papered moths called Piston Betularia were prevalent in very high number. The papered moths are nocturnal in habit. During daytime, they rest on the tree trunk. Their pale body color camouflaged well with the lichen-covered trees that help them to escape from the predatory bird. On the contrary, the black-colored moth called Piston Carbonaria resting on lichen-covered tree trunks were very conspicuous, and they were easily seen by the predatory birds, and so their number was very less. During the Industrial Revolution, large number of industries came up in Great Britain. The industries released black sooty smoke that killed the lichens growing on trees and turned the tree black due to the sooty deposit. This change became an advantage to the black-colored moths that camouflaged well with the black tree trunk. So their population started increasing, and now the pale-colored moths were seen easily by the predatory birds, and their population started reducing. Thus, natural selection has resulted in the establishment of a phenotypic trait in changing the environmental condition. Then next concept, isolation. Separation of a single population into several subunits is isolation. No interbreeding between isolated groups occur. Each group may develop a set of new traits that led to evolutionary changes and towards formation of new species. In this, geographical isolation. It occurs when an original population is separated into two or more groups by geographical barriers such as river, mountain, ocean, etc. The separated groups are exposed to different kinds of environmental factors. So the separated population develop distinct gene pool and they do not interbreed. Then reproductive isolation. Reproductive isolation is brought about by the change in genetic material, gene pool, and structure of genital organ. Now, the types of isolating mechanism. 1. Pre-mating or pre-zygotic isolating mechanism. In habitat isolation, members of a population living in the same region occupy different habitats. Thus, potential mates do not meet. In seasonal isolation, members of a population attain sexual maturity at the different times, thus preventing interbreeding. In ethological isolation, members of two populations have different mating behaviors, so this prevents interbreeding. In mechanical isolation, the members of two populations have differences in the structure of reproductive organs, so interbreeding is not possible. Secondly, post-mating or post-zygotic isolating mechanisms are gamete mortality, where sperm's transfer takes place but egg is not fertilized, and zygote mortality, where egg is fertilized but zygote dies, and hybrid sterility, that means hybrids are sterile. Now, biological evidence. The present-day complex forms have originated or evolved forms have originated or evolved from the simple forms of the past. Process is supported by the evidences provided by various branches of biology such as paleontology, comparative anatomy, embryology, and genetics. So first, paleontological evidence. Fossils are defined as the dead remains of plants and animals that lived in the past in various geological layers. Fossils are the true witnesses or documents of evolution. These are formed in sedimentary rocks, amber, volcanic gas, ice, peat bogs, and soil, etc. Now, types of fossils. Fossils fall under three main categories. 1. Actual remains. These are generally formed in the deep oceans. Whenever the plants or animals die, their dead bodies sink to the bottom of the sea. Another way is incorporation of the entire body or part of the body in the ice. Then molds. A mold is an impression of the body parts left on the soft mud on the oceanic floor. Cast. When the cavities of the mold get filled with minerals, it hardens into stones and forms cast. Significance. It is useful in reconstructing the evolutionary history of the organism, and it helps in studying various other forms and structure of extinct animals. Then connective link. It is an intermediate or transitional stage between two organisms. It possesses structures common to both the groups, thus indicating the evolutionary line. It is also called the missing link. For example, Archaeopteryx is the connecting link between birds and reptiles and thus shares characters of both the classes. It had a long tail like reptile supported internally by several caudal vertebrae, and scales were present on the body, bones were solid, not pneumatized. Avian character of Archaeopteryx was feathery exoskeleton, skull bones completely fused, cranium rounded with large orbits and a single condyle, jaws modified into beak, forelimbs modified into wing. Now, evidences from comparative anatomy. When structures of different groups of organisms are studied in a comparative manner, it is observed that they exhibit similarities indicating a common origin. Following aspects offer evidence. 1. Homologous organ. These are those organs which are structurally similar but functionally dissimilar. The phenomenon is homology. For example, four limbs of terrestrial vertebrates such as frog, lizard, bird, bat, whale, and man. In all these cases, morphologically, the four limbs are similar in construction but dissimilar in function. In frogs, they are useful in hopping. In lizards, they help in crawling. In birds and bats, they help in flying. In whales, for swimming. In man, gripping the object. Then, analogous organs. These are structurally dissimilar and functionally similar. They do not help to trace the relationship and hence they do not have a significant role in evolution. For example, wings of birds and insects, in both cases, they are useful in flight, structurally different. The wings of insects are expansions of exoskeleton, where wings of birds are modified four limbs. Then vestigial organs. These are those which are functionless organs. That means they are useless to the animals, hence their presence is not required. However, they continue to exist before they degenerate and disappear in the process of evolution. For example, in man, cecum and vermiform appendix is still seen and it is functionless organ. It helps in cellulose digestion in herbivorous mammals. Coccyx or tail vertebra, it is the remnant of a tail in human. Then embryological evidences. All living organisms in their early developmental stages show presence of following distinct features. 1. Development in sexually reproducing organisms begin from a single diploid cell stage, that is a fertilized egg or zygote. 2. Zygote undergoes cleavage, blastulation and gastrulation. At the end, 3 germ layers are formed which give rise to various organs and organ systems. Embryos of different vertebrae, that is from fishes to mammals, look alike particularly with reference to gill slits, gill clefts and tail. From these similarities, it can be concluded that all these groups have evolved from the same ancestral stock. Then molecular evidence. All organisms show presence of endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi bodies, mitochondria as cell organelle. ATP is the energy currency in all the living organisms. Then mechanism of evolution. Different theories of evolution were put forward and mutation and genetic drift is the change in gene frequency in population, which is an important factor. Then geological time scale. The major divisions of geological time are called eras, and the eras are divided into periods and the periods into epochs. The eras, periods and epochs are arranged on the time scale in an order of their age, and this arrangement is called geological time scale. Then adaptive radiation, the process of evolution which results in transformation of original species to many different varieties is called adaptive radiation. Then Hardy-Weinberg's principle. The principle states that gene, that is allele or genotype, frequencies remain same from generation to generation unless disturbed by factors like mutation, non-random mating, genetic drift, etc. If we take example of two alleles of a single locus, capital A and small a, and the frequencies small p and small q, the frequency of AA is p square, for small aa q square, for capital A small a 2pq, and it is explained like this. Place of humans in the animal kingdom. The modern man is included in the order primates of class Mammalia, along with the prosimians, monkeys, and apes. The order primates is divided into two suborders, Prosimi and Anthropoida. The major groups of primates related to human evolution are as follows. Suborder Prosimi, lemurs. These are small arboreal animals mainly found in Madagascar. Then tarsiers. These are arboreal, nocturnal, insectivorous primates found on islands of East Indies. Then suborder Anthropoida. 1. New World monkeys. They have flat noses with widely separated nostrils. Then Old World monkeys. They have narrow noses, short, non-prehensile tails, and 32 teeth. Then Hominoida. It includes apes and man. Apes have slanting forehead, snout protruded with flat nose, teeth large, and canines, which accommodates elongated canine of the lower jaw. Then man, the special features of man are development of high forehead, skull dome shape, elevated nose, dental arch rounded parabola, small jaws, and development of prominent chin. Then phylogenetic relationship between apes and man. The characteristics of apes and man are absence of tail, comparatively larger head, broad chest due to flattening of sternum, capable of sound production, menstrual cycle in females. Then human evolution, paleontological evidences. The ancestors of man lived on trees, but man is terrestrial animal. Man originated from ancient apes. Fossil bones of human ancestors are discovered from Africa, Germany, and other parts of Asia. The available fossils are skulls, mandibles, teeth, bones like humerus and femur. There are four main stages in the origin of man. First one, ape stage. Second one, ape main stage. Then primitive man, that is prehistoric man. These are the important primitive men. 1. Homo habilis, that is handy man. Then Homo erectus, that is Peking man. And Homo neanderthaliensis, that is Neanderthal man. Then modern man. It includes all the existing men and also some extinct men. Cro-Magnon man, called Homo sapiens fossils, was the extinct modern man. The modern man of today is called Homo sapiens sapiens. Some important human ancestors reconstructed from the available fossil records. 1. Proplyopithecus. It was an ape-like primate. Then Dryopithecus, that is Proconsul. Then Ramapithecus. It was an ape-man-like primate. Then Australopithecus, the first fossil in the form of skull cap of a child. The ape-like characters of Australopithecus are the jaws and teeth larger than those of modern man, but chin was absent. The man-like characters of Australopithecus are it was about 4 feet in height, walked nearly or completely straight. The Australopithecus is rightly described as a man with a brain. Then Homo habilis. The fossils of this primitive man were discovered from Tanzania. The lower jaw was lightly built and the dentition was more like that of modern man. Then Homo erectus. It was the first true man. This primitive man lived in Java and Peking. Java man. The Homo erectus fossils of Java were called Java man. It was about 5 feet in height and walked erect. The jaws were massive with huge teeth and the chin was absent. Then Peking man. The fossils were discovered in cave near Peking, China. It was similar to Java man, with heavy bony eyebrow ridges, low slanting forehead and chinless face. Then Heidelberg man. It was discovered in Germany. It was ancestor to Neanderthal man. Then Neanderthal man. Its first fossil was collected from Neanderthal Valley in Germany. These were heavily built and short. They had prominent brow ridges. The skull bones were thick, forehead was low and slanting, and the jaw was deep with no chin. Then Cro-Magnon man. It was discovered in France. They were about 180 cm in height with large skull, rounded forehead, distinct chin, narrow nose, eyebrow ridges thin and broad face. Then modern man. It includes all the human beings existing today on the earth.